Be sure that you have all the necessary tools and materials on hand before beginning the construction of your pool. Not having the appropriate items on hand when they are called for can make the job much more difficult than it needs to be. If you have not already done so, separate the different kinds of hardware. This will make it easier to find the necessary pieces when they are called for, and help you to become familiar with the different types of hardware you will be using during the assembly of your pool. In choosing the site to assemble your pool, you want to avoid areas with steep slopes or underground obstructions. You also must be sure that the site you choose complies with all state and local codes. A transit is the easiest and most precise way to tell you how level your site is. Transits are easy to use and can be rented at most local equipment rental outlets. If you do not have access to a transit, a long straight board with a carpenter's level will do the job. Once you have determined exactly where your pool will be going, remove all of the sod from inside that area. The pool cannot be installed on top of any grass. A great tool for removing sod quickly and neatly is a sod cutter. This is also a tool that can be rented at a local equipment rental center, and you can be taught easily how to use it in a matter of minutes. If you do not have a sod cutter, this can be done manually by using a shovel. It is important that you dig down the high areas and do not build up the low areas. Building up the low areas will cause the pool to settle and possibly cause major problems down the road. The entire area should be within 1 inch of being perfectly level before proceeding to the next step. Measure off from the ends of your site and stake off the center point for your pool. Bring your pre-assembled buttress or your buttress-free assemblies onto the site. Using your stake center point as a guide, lay out the assemblies for your size pool as per your installation instruction booklet. Attach the straight side bottom rail connectors to the strap end channels as we show here. There are two different size straps packed with each pool. Each strap is marked with a part number and the length. Consult your instruction booklet to make sure you are using the correct size and quantities of strap sections for your pool. Assemble straps using half-inch long bolts and nuts. Make sure they are as tight as possible using hand tools. Most oval pools have three different length bottom rails. They're color-coded by length on one end. The corner bottom rails are used on most size ovals as a transition piece from the straight sides to the curved sides. The straight side bottom rails are used between each of the straight side upright assemblies. The curved side bottom rails are the longest ones, and they are used to form the curved sides of your pool. Please be aware that some pools use resin bottom rails instead of the metal rails. Be sure you are using the correct bottom rails and not the stabilizer rails. Most stabilizer rails for the curved sides have a male and female end, so they are crimped on one side. These rails are also smaller in size than the bottom rails are. There are a few different kinds of bottom plates that we use. The most common is the metal bottom plate. Some pools use a resin bottom plate. Here is an example. Others will use a resin bottom cuff. Here is an example. Assemble your bottom track by sliding the bottom rail into the bottom plate up to the dimple on the plate. This is done exactly the same way for pools with resin bottom plates and rails. Resin bottom cuff pools are also done in the same fashion. Most oval pools have four different length stabilizer rails. The stabilizers are the rails with the smaller profile, and they are usually unpainted. These rails will also be color-coded by size. Do not use these rails on the bottom of the pool. Install the straight side bottom rails by inserting them into the straight side bottom rail connectors and pushing them down. This will help you establish the correct spacing between the straight side assemblies. In order to make sure the straight side uprights are parallel with each other, we measure the distance from the house to each upright, making sure each measurement is the same. If you are not close enough to an existing structure, such as a house or fence, to do this, you can draw a string along the straight sides to get the same effect. Each of the strap end channels should be sitting 42 inches on center from the channel or channels next to it. Measure from the first straight side upright on one side to the last straight side upright on the opposite side. Then measure the two opposite uprights. The measurements should be identical. If they are not, you should move the uprights until those measurements are the same. Once you are confident that everything is laid out properly, check the site again to see how level it is. You should now temporarily remove the straight side bottom rails so that you can level the strap end channels. Mark the area around the strap end channel so that you know where to dig. The strap end channel is 2 inches tall, so you will need to trench out a 2 inch deep area where the strap end channel sits, so that the top of the strap end channel is flush with the top of the ground. Place the oval upright assembly into the trench. Make sure the upright is level using a carpenter's level. Repeat this process for all assemblies. Clean up and level the area between the oval upright assemblies and replace the straight side bottom rails so that they are sitting flat on the ground. Clean up the areas between the strap end channels inside the pool so the pressure plates will also sit flat on the ground. Lay out the pressure plates so that the holes in the center of each plate line up with the holes in the center of each strap end channel. Secure pressure plates to the strap end channels using two number 12 screws in each. Connect the pressure plates to each other using three number 12 screws at each point that the plates overlap each other.